Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
When you have got a question and you just can't figure it out, just give us a shout and call the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaramba.
And I'm Donna Minio. Homework Hotline is the place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or on TV.
Here's how it works. Teachers from Dial-A-Teacher are standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you would like help with your homework, call Dial-A-Teacher free at 1-888-986-2345.
You can also send us your questions on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Just click on the Act Back button and send in your question. All right, we're going to get to our creature teaser in just a moment, but first, we would like to let our viewers know that a little later in the show, Cara Verno from the Rochester Museum and Science Center will be here with some creepy crawlers for Valentine's Day.
Now, let's get to tonight's creature teaser.
All right, this creature is found in the deserts of northwestern Mexico and the northwest United States. It is the largest lizard found in the United States. It has black bead-like scales with yellow, orange, or pink patterns that warn other animals that it is poisonous. This creature uses its venom more than on predators than on prey.
It clamps its powerful jaw down on its victim, and its venom flows from its grooved bottom teeth. This carnivore is bulky and moves slowly, so it feeds primarily on eggs and newborn mammals, such as squirrels and rabbits. It spends 95% of its time underground, surfacing only for food and sunshine. It does not have to eat often because it stores fat in its large tail. If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. We have some homework.
Yes, we do. We had someone from New York City call in a geometry problem.
All
and
right.
I'm going to go to the board and do that.
Sounds like a plan.
All right, come on over. We're going to go do this geometry problem. And this person was a seventh grader, so they're just starting geometry. It's brand new. And they had a straight line with another ray off of it, creating two angles, angle one and angle two. And they said that angle one is 5x and angle two is x minus 6. Well, the first thing I would have my students do is I would have them label it, write it right into your diagram. This way, there's no question as to which angle you're talking about. So we're going to write 5x here, and then we're going to write x minus 6 here. This way, we know when we get our answers, we can go right back up into our diagram and find the answer, okay? Now, we have a straight line and we have a ray coming off of it. So what you're learning right now is that these two angles are supplementary. They create the straight line. And by creating a straight line, they actually create 180 degrees. So we're going to, I just want to show you a little trick to help you with that before we get into the math. Supplementary, if you spell it out, the first letter is an S. If you connect the two ends of the S, it makes an 8. So that reminds you of 180, okay? And if you did complementary and you see and you drew a line down, it would give you a 9. All right, that'll help you remember those numbers. So now let's get back to the actual mathematics and not just vocab. I have two angles. Supplementary means two angles that add together and give you 180. So we're going to write the 5x. And then we're going to add, and I always tell my students to put the angle in parentheses to begin with, just so that you know that it's all there. And then it's going to equal 180. Okay, so now, as we're working, because I just did that, there's no numbers on the outside or anything, but I know that both angles are here because here's the first one and here's the second one. Now what we're gonna do is we're just gonna get rid of the parentheses. It's like multiplying by a one. So 5x plus x minus 6 is 180. You now have to combine like terms. And if you look at the problem, I have two variables that have x's here, and a minus 6 and an 80, 180. So what we're going to do is we're going to combine those x's. So circling them will help you remember to put them together. So I'm going to do that, and I have 5, and remember there's an imaginary 1 there. It's invisible, because in algebra, 1 can be invisible in front of the variable. 5 plus 1 is 6. So I now have 6x minus 6 is equal to 180. And we're going to keep going, and now we just have a simple two-step equation. We're going to draw our line here just so that what you do on one side of that balanced line, you have to do on the other side. So now we have a minus 6. This has to move to the other side. It doesn't have a variable, so it has to move over. So we do the opposite. Subtract 6. We're going to now add 6. This one comes down. So I have 6x on the left, and I have 186 on the right. Now, this seems to be a problem with some of my students. They don't remember that 6 and x next to each other actually means to multiply. And in order to do the opposite, you have to divide. So we're going to divide by 6. All right, so now I have 1x, because 6 divided by 6 is 1. So I have 1x is equal to, well, let's see, 6 doesn't go into 1, but it goes into 18 3 times. 6 goes into 6 1 time. So my x is 31. Now I have to go back up to the diagram. Remember, we labeled our diagram with the math, with the equation, or the expressions, I'm sorry. So now we found x is 31. Just plug it in. We know that this is 5 times 31. Which equals 155, and don't forget your little degree mark. And make sure it's little and doesn't look like a zero, because sometimes that will be a mess up for the teacher's degrading. And now we gotta do the same over here. Plug in your 31, take away the 6, and you get 25. And a nice way to check, take these two numbers that you got and actually add them up. 155 plus 25. 5 and 5 is 10, carry 1 and 5 is 6, plus 2 is 8, bring the 1, I got 180, so I know I've got the right answers because it's supposed to equal 180 when we're done. All right, I hope that helps.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial a Teacher is open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
All right, we're going to go back to the questions in just a minute, but now we'd like to welcome Kara back to the homework hotline. Hi, Kara. How are you?
Hi. Good, how are you?
So what do you got for us today?
So here we have Harold. He is a Madagascar hissing cockroach.
Cool.
And they're located
in Madagascar, which some kids think that that's just a movie, but it's actually a real place, which is an island off of Africa.
So cockroaches get a bad name, but are they really that bad?
They're really not that bad. 99% of most cockroaches aren't going to be the ones that are living in your house. Okay. They're actually going to be living on forest floors under tree bark and shrubs and things like that.
What do they eat?
These guys will eat almost anything. They're scavengers, they're opportunistic, they'll eat whatever they can find. Ours, we feed different fruits, different vegetables, but they also love things like Cheerios as a treat, and dried dog food as well.
Cheerios.
But in the wild, they'll eat rotten fruits, vegetables, things like that are on the
floor. How long does this insect live?
2 years, 3 years,
really?
Sometimes.
Oh,
they can actually live up to 5, though.
That's a long time for an insect.
It's pretty long, yeah. Okay. It's a good lifespan.
Tell us a little bit about the exoskeleton of this animal.
Yeah, so insects are very interesting where they have an exoskeleton, which is this hardened shell that you'll see on the outside of them. We have an endoskeleton, so ours is actually inside, the opposite from these guys, which it is outside. So, he's going to hiss for it. So this is just hard to the touch, and it helps to protect him. It's almost like an armor. Okay. It'll help to protect what's inside of him.
Nice.
He's an insect, so he's also got the six legs.
Okay.
And he's got three body parts. He's got his head, which is actually underneath here.
Yeah, you're showing that.
And then he's got his thorax
earlier.
And his abdomen is this light part here.
Cool.
Wow.
Yeah.
So how can you tell if it's a male or a female?
So with the males, they have a prominent horn, it looks like, on the top of their head. So you'll notice these two big bumps that are right here.
Nice.
They use them in battles. So they try to show dominance between males. So the bigger the horns.
Like horns,
gotcha. The bigger the horns,
they actually fight.
Better. Yeah, they do. They do fight.
Okay, why do they hiss?
So they hiss as a defense, and you can actually hear them. They're very, very loud when they hiss. They use it as a defense. They can also use it, again, in those fights. It helps to prove dominance. The louder the hiss, the more angry it is.
Right. Okay.
So they'll use it for dominance. They'll also just use it if they're distressed or being handled or something along those lines.
Very cool.
All right, he's cool looking.
Yes, he is.
Isn't he great?
Yeah.
Harold,
yep.
Show your face to everybody.
Yeah, so this is actually his face, which is underneath. It's this little triangle part that's underneath.
Now you brought us another insect?
I did bring another insect.
Not an insect.
So it's going to be not an insect. It's going to be a little different from our friend here. Insects, again, have six legs, and they have three body parts.
So what's the difference between an insect and a bug?
So a bug, it can be a type of insect.
Gotcha.
There are true bugs that are types of insects.
Gotcha. Yeah. Ooh,
so this guy here, this
scary.
This is Vinny. Vinny is what is called a vinegaroon scorpion.
Cool.
So he's a type of arachnid.
Yes.
So he's going to have eight legs, which he's got these three here, and then he's got two that he uses as feelers out here. He's also got two that are look like pinchers, and those two. I'll try and turn them so you can see them a little bit better. His pinchers there, people think are used to pinch or to hurt, and that's why they get nervous when I pick him right up, but they really use it to eat. They use them almost like hands. Put the prey in their mouth.
All right. How is a scorpion different from a hissing cockroach?
So this guy here, he's got the eight legs versus the six.
Yep.
He still has the exoskeleton, but he's only got two body parts here instead of the three.
Cephalothorax.
Yeah, exactly, right. Exactly.
I teach science, I know this one. So where are these guys located?
These guys are going to be southern United States. You find them in Arizona, places like that.
Florida, Louisiana, places like that.
But you're not going to find them in your shoe. You know, you can find some scorpions. They make you check your shoes and things like that. These guys aren't going to be there. You're going to find them more under rocks and things like that, high elevations.
Okay.
So you just told us a little bit about where they find them in the surroundings, but like, are they out in gardens and things like that? Where do you find them?
No, higher elevations, definitely. So you're not going to find them near your houses. You'll find them up on mountains and things like that.
Now, can you tell us a little bit about how these things would raise their young or about their young?
Yeah, so their young, once they have their eggs hatched, they actually ride on their back until their first molt, ride on the mom's back until their first molt. Yeah, and then they'll molt four times throughout their life. So about a year apart, and after each molt is when they'll grow a little bit bigger.
Molting means they're going to shed their
skin, little skin, exoskeleton.
Snakes.
Yep, exactly.
Okay.
Same idea. It'll come off fairly soft in the beginning, and then it takes about a year for it to harden and get to be like this.
Like circadians, you see them stuck on the side of a tree or something like that.
Yeah.
And then just a shell. Excellent.
Sure. Yep.
Okay. Why is the word vinegar in the name?
So people ask that all the time. They kind of nicknamed them vinegaroon scorpions. That's because they have this really nice, cool whip tail that they have. It's a very long tail. Underneath that, they can actually release a smell or a scent, and it's acid, and it smells just like vinegar.
Right.
They'll actually spray that right in their predators. They have very good aim, so right in their face usually.
Right.
And then that predator's got to clean it off, and they see him running away shaking their head because they don't like it, obviously.
Well, don't point that tail toward me.
Eyesight. How are these guys for sight?
So they don't have great eyesight, which is surprising because they do have eight eyes. They have three on each side and two in the front. So you would think that they'd, more eyes the better, but no, they don't have great eyesight. They're nocturnal.
I'd hate to buy glasses for that.
Exactly, right? I think it's expensive for your two eyes. Can you imagine?
Now, Are these, like, in the very front there? Mm-hmm. Are those claws, or?
So they use these.
What is it?
These things here, which are they're claw-like, and they use them to actually pick up their prey and put it towards their mouth, which is pretty cool.
And the mouth is the other
piece, right back in there?
Okay, because that sort of look like nails coming out there. Yep.
Now, do they use their antennas like some insects do, where they'll go out and use them as a feelers?
They actually use these first two appendages, yes, as feelers. They also use their tail for that, too.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Excellent.
They use both things.
All right. Well, thank you very much
thank
for
you.
Coming.
It was nice to see you guys again.
It's nice to see you.
Cool.
Want to know more about this animal and others like it? Go to our website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos. Stay right there. We'll be back in a second.
King Philip came over for great spaghetti is a silly way to remember the classification of animals and plants in science. The classification order is kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species.
Some of those insects are cool, but up close, it's like, ugh.
Yeah, I know. I didn't want to touch it.
All right. I'm going to continue with my circulatory system.
Okay, that sounds great. Thank you.
So I mentioned the other day when we were talking about our circulatory system that we have a closed circulatory system. That means the blood that we have in our body stays within the vessels. If you looked at like the hissing cockroach and the scorpion that we just had on here, they have an open system where their blood kind of circulates within their exoskeletons, all right? So we have arteries. They carry blood away from the heart. It's under high pressure. It's bright red, all right? Remember, your blood is never blue. They use it as an illustration. Your blood gets dark red when it doesn't have any oxygen. We have a couple main arteries. The pulmonary artery is the goes to the right from the right ventricle to the lungs, and this is the only artery in your body that carries low oxygen blood because it's going from the heart to the lungs to drop off the blood to drop off the carbon dioxide. The aorta goes from the left ventricle to the rest of the body. It's about as big around as your thumb. Very big delivery system for the blood. We have veins that carry blood back to the heart. Again, this is under low pressure. It's your skeleton muscles that squeeze around the veins and cause the blood to be forced in one direction. They have one-way valves. And the last thing we talked about was our capillaries, where the arteries and veins connect. And this is where these blood vessels are so thin that only one blood cell can go through at a time. All right, the last part with our circulatory system is our lymphatic system, all right? And this is another system that kind of goes hand in hand with our circulatory system. A system that, and what this does for us is it filters out waste that leaks out of your cells into your body system that your body needs to get rid of, all right? And if you think of this as a filter, it does just that. So if, let's say you, like the other day, I got a sliver of wood in my finger and it got infected and it got all red. And so right away, my body's gonna start acting on that, sending fighter cells down there from my lymphatic system to help fight this infection that I'm at. In the meantime, it's gotta filter that stuff out of my body so it doesn't continue to build up in my system. All right, now we have what's known as lymph vessels in our body. We have big ones that run underneath our arms and the inside of our legs, and then we have a whole bunch of them that run throughout the middle of your body. All right, there is no pump for this lymphatic system. Again, it's the skeletal muscles that squeeze on these vessels and cause this liquid to return back to your circulatory system. Right up around here near your collarbone, there's a little place near your heart that has a place where this stuff collects and then gets back into your blood system. All right. One other thing is we have lymphocytes, which are special cells within that the lymph system. They're not really blue, but they're staying a little color, so you can see them. The little donut-looking ones are red blood cells, and then these are the lymphocytes. And these things go out, and your body produces these to help fight infection when you get an infection in your body. The last part is we have these lymph nodes, all right? When you go to the doctor, you sit on the table and the doctor puts his hands on your neck. And one thing he's doing is he's checking to see if your lymph nodes are swollen or tender. And if you go in there with a sore throat, you're gonna know right away. He's gonna like, yeah, those are kind of infected. And he looks inside, oh, you got strep or some other kind of infection going on. These things act like a filter. They remove, they get swollen, they get tender when you have an infection either in the limb or in your throat or in the abdomen or in your body part, all right? So this finishes up our circulatory system. And when we go later on, we're gonna continue with some of the other body systems, and I hope this helps you guys out. Thanks a lot.
Need help with your homework? Call Dial a Teacher for free at 1-888-986-2345. And don't forget, Dial-A-Teacher's open Monday through Thursday from 3:30 to 7 p.m.
That was really cool.
Thanks.
And when they did this, I always thought they were checking my tonsils.
Well, no, you've got little lymph nodes there, and they get swollen and tender. You get a neck infection or strep throat or something.
Yeah, I just thought it was always they were checking my tonsils. Yeah. I didn't know that they could do the lymph nodes.
And
you
can help it along, like if you get infection by pushing towards the trunk to help get that stuff filtered out of your body faster.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
Wow. Well, I'm working on some algebra with my seventh graders,
and they're
having a little bit of trouble, so I'd like to do a little mini lesson for them.
Cool.
Okay? All right. What I have here is we're going to solve multi-step algebraic equations. So don't let algebra scare you kids, because algebra is nothing more than we're going to solve an equation that has a variable in it. You're used to algebra. Way back in the elementary school, you did boxes. Those were your variables, your box. So now we're just going to use an X instead of a box. So now when you look at this problem that I wrote here, I actually have three times, and the parentheses are red, the quantity, negative 2x plus 6, and then we're going to subtract 15 from all of that, and it's going to equal 21. So what you got to do first is get rid of the parentheses. You really need to do the distributive property. So we're going to take this number here, the 3, and we're going to multiply everything in the parentheses by that. So we're going to say 3 times negative 2 is a negative 6x. 3 times 6 is an 18. And then we have the minus 15. We're just going to carry it. And then we have the 21. So now what you need to do in order to make this still look a little bit neater and a little bit nicer is we're going to combine like terms on the left-hand side. So we're going to combine this positive 18 and this minus 15. And you notice I said minus. To subtract is the same as a negative. Subtracting is the same as adding a negative. So we're going to just take these and take them as their signs. I have a positive 18 and a negative 15. Different signs, we have to subtract. So 18 minus 15 is 3. Now, which one did I have more of? Do I have more positives or do I have more negatives? Well, hopefully you said positives, because 18 is bigger than 15. So we have more positives. And we're just going to bring this one down. So I have negative 6x plus 3 equals 21. So now you're back down to this big ugly problem became this two-step problem that you all know how to do. So now what we're going to do, you draw your balance bar, because remember what you're trying to do is keep that equal. And on like a seesaw, if somebody's on, there's two people over here and you're one person here and you're balanced, and all of a sudden somebody goes off, the person over here is going to go flying. It's going to go flying off. So you got to keep things balanced. So now all I tell my students is, you look, here's a plus 3. Well, how do I make that a 0? You're going to subtract 3. So we're going to take away the 3, bring down that negative 6x. And 21 minus 3 is the same as 20 minus 2. That's how I do my math in my head, and I get 18. So now I just have to do the opposite. I've got negative 6 times x. So that's times in there. Divide is how you undo, or you get it to become 1. So negative 6 divided by 6 is negative 1. Or positive 1. Sorry, I misspoke. Now, I do it on the other side again, balance beam. So we have x is equal to, and how many 6s are in 18? Well, we know that's 3. And then all we have to do is a positive divided by a negative is a negative. So that becomes my answer for that problem. I hope that helped.
Newton's first law of motion states that an object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to stay in motion with the same direction and speed unless interfered with.
All right, we have a winner in tonight's creature teaser. I believe Lucas is on the phone.
Hi, Lucas.
Hello.
So what is this creature that we are teasing you about?
Monster.
Wow, cool.
All right, now, what clues did we give you that helped you figure that out?
What?
How did you know this?
Well, I watched Wildcrest.
All right.
All right. Now, how did you know how to call it a Gila monster? Because when I first looked at the name, I didn't call it a Gila monster. I called it a Gila monster.
Right.
Well, there's different ways of saying it.
All right.
Okay.
So is there something that you learned that you'd like to share with us about the Gila monster?
Well, so it has a powerful bite.
Right.
And sometimes, under rare conditions, it could go under your porch.
Ooh.
Oh.
Okay. Well, that's good,
All
Lucas.
Right,
cool.
That's good, yes.
Congratulations, Lucas. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet just like Lucas at the end of the season.
That's all the time we have for tonight. We're saying goodbye, but Dial-A-Teacher is available with free homework help on the phone until 7 tonight.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, we'll continue our celebration of Black History Month. Good night.
Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.